Thank you so much, Emilio. Thank you. Thank you all. What a pleasure it is to be back here yet again. I'm so grateful to Ron Robinson and his team for inviting me. I want to begin by expressing my deep condolences to Ron on the death of his brother. I had been so looking forward to being with Ron today and was really sad to learn of his brother's death. But it is a great pleasure to be with all of you and with the staff of the YAF. I come here every year. They're kind enough to invite me back. Before and after my talks, I meet so many wonderful young men and women, and my reaction when I talk to one of you is always, why isn't that kid at Princeton, you know? But I do want to announce that we are accepting transfer students. We used to not do that, but we do it now. So I hope those of you who are in college will consider that. I want to thank Ben Keene, who's been my chaperone or my handler here today. Thank you, Ben. Great to be with Ben. You know, as a professor, especially in the Ivy League, I spend so much of my time with not only academics, but with future academics, or if not with future academics, future lawyers and future politicians. And it was so nice to be with someone who has decided to go into a respectable line of work like welding. Good for you, Ben. I think that's fantastic. And I also, in deference to a dear friend of mine, a kind of honorary kid's sister, who insisted that I announce to you that I have a presence, despite my advanced age. I have a presence on social media. So if you want to look at what I'm up to on Twitter, I'm at McCormick Prof. And although my Facebook limit of friends has been reached, I do conduct my Facebook page as a kind of ongoing, I hope Senator Hawley will forgive me, as a sort of ongoing seminar on things I'm interested in, including moral and political philosophy and philosophy of law and constitutional law and religion and wine and music. And if you would like to be a friend, just private message me and tell me that you're connected with YAF and you go to the top of the list. I'd love to have you. 41 years ago, a man with a craggy face and a beard came to Harvard University, where I was then a graduate student, to give the annual commencement address. The man was not a Harvard graduate. He was not a professor or a politician or a CEO. He was not an American. He did not speak English. His address, given in his native Russian with a simultaneous English translation, was not especially well received. I suspect that some Harvard officials regretted, some perhaps deeply regretted, the decision to invite him to speak. The man's name was Alexander Solzhenitsyn, the brilliant novelist who had spent years as a political prisoner in the Gulag in the Soviet Union. Solzhenitsyn was a strong Orthodox Christian and a fierce critic of atheistic communism and Soviet tyranny. His writings had exposed the corruption, the cruelty, the injustice of the communist regime that had come to power in Russia in the Bolshevik Revolution of 1917 and would remain in power until the day after Christmas, 1991. A regime that had enslaved its own people and reduced those of many other nations to serfdom under Soviet puppet governments. It was a regime every bit as totalitarian and murderous as the Nazi regime in Germany, which the US and Britain had allied with the Soviets in World War II to defeat. In 1978, when Solzhenitsyn spoke at Harvard, the Cold War was still raging. The US was still reeling from its humiliation in the disastrous war in Vietnam. Anti-Americanism was flourishing both abroad and at home. Many Americans, particularly young Americans at the time, had lost faith in their country. They'd lost faith in their country's institutions, in its principles, in its culture, its traditions, its way of life. Some proposed communism as a superior way. Many suggested what came to be known as moral equivalency between American democracy democratic capitalism, and Soviet communism. By 1978, to suggest such equivalency had become a mark of sophistication, something to distinguish someone from the allegedly backward hicks and rubes who believed in the superiority of the American to the Soviet system. There were many such sophisticated people at Harvard. And Alexander Solzhenitsyn had come to Harvard to confront them. His speech was not, however, any sort of encomium to the West or to America. On the contrary, it was a severe critique, one might even call it a prophetic rebuke and a warning. Of course, Solzhenitsyn did not argue for the moral superiority or moral equivalency of the Soviet system, no, no. He hated communism in all its dimensions, and he loathed, with a loathing beyond all understanding, the gangsters who ruled the Soviet Empire. What he faulted America and the West for was its abandonment of its own moral and especially spiritual ideals and identity, its patrimony, its heritage. Solzhenitsyn viewed the West as weak, and its weakness, he saw, prevented it from standing up as it should stand up to Soviet aggression. And he saw the source of this weakness in the materialism, the consumerism, the self-indulgent individualism, the emotivism, the narcissism, in a word, the immorality into which we had allowed ourselves to sink. Solzhenitsyn, the by then internationally acclaimed legendary human rights activist, warned America and the West that we had become too focused on rights and needed to refocus, to bring into focus the other side of rights, obligations, responsibility, moral responsibility. We had come, Solzhenitsyn said, to embrace a false understanding of liberty, conceiving it as simply doing as one pleases, rather than as the freedom to fulfill one's human potential and to honor one's conscientious duties to God, to family, to neighbor. Now, at the heart of this moral confusion and collapse, Solzhenitsyn argued, was a loss of faith. And with it, the loss of a particular virtue, one that I want to commend to your attention today. Senator Hawley, in his fine speech, mentioned it as well. That particular virtue is the virtue of courage. Here are Solzhenitsyn's own words. A decline in courage may be the most striking feature which an outside observer notices in the West today. The Western world has lost its civil courage, both as a whole and separately, in each country, each government, each political party, and of course in the United Nations. Such a decline in courage is particularly noticeable among the ruling groups and the intellectual elite, causing an impression of the loss of courage by the entire society. Of course, there are many courageous individuals, but they have no determining influence on public life, unquote. Now, of course, a couple of years later, the American people would elect Ronald Reagan, who had the courage to stand up for American ideals and institutions and confront the Soviet menace. But I submit to you today that despite that, and despite our victory in the Cold War, for which we should all be grateful, and despite the collapse and disappearance of the Soviet Union, nothing has changed that would diminish the force or relevance of Solzhenitsyn's words And we would do well, my young friends, to heed those words, that warning. The virtue we lack, the virtue we still lack, and it is an indispensable virtue, is courage. And we must recover it. Our young men and women, you young men and women, must regain it, not to defend us from a hostile foreign power armed with nuclear weapons, but to protect us from a far more dangerous foe, a truly deadly enemy, namely our own worst selves. At all times and in all places, all of the virtues are needed. No virtue is superfluous. None is dispensable. But it seems that at any given time, in any given place, particular society, there is a particular virtue that is lacking and therefore desperately needed. Moreover, because the virtues are integrally connected one to another, they're like a network, the loss of any one virtue tends to weaken and imperil all the others. Or worse, the loss of a given virtue threatens to turn other virtues into engines of vice. Let me explain by way of an example. Take, for example, the virtue of compassion. It is an essential virtue, a true virtue, a necessary virtue, like the others. It can move us to work selflessly and even heroically for the good of our fellow human beings, especially those who are needy or who are suffering. We cannot do without the virtue of compassion. We rightly praise compassionate people for their good deeds in caring for the least and the last and the lost. But consider what can happen, what has happened. When compassion remains strong, but other virtues, such as love of truth and justice, have eroded or disappeared. Operating by itself in isolation from the other virtues, compassion can motivate every manner of evil, from the killing of the unborn in abortion to the killing of the disabled and the frail elderly in euthanasia. We can convince ourselves, many people have convinced themselves, that kindness, compassion, calls for these things. Well before the Nazis gave eugenics a bad name, well-intentioned, decent, compassionate people, not only in Germany, but in the West and in the United States, in England, well-meaning people embraced eugenics precisely out of a sense of compassion. It was they, the progressive people, the well-educated people, the polite people, people who had no sympathy for the Nazis in the Weimar Republic or in England or here in the United States prior to the rise of the Nazis, who invented the doctrine of Lebens unswertes Leben, the idea that there were some lives unworthy of life. Indeed, the book by that title, Lebens unswertes Leben, Lives Unworthy of Life, was written during the Weimar period, not under the Nazis, in the democratic period before the rise of the Nazis, by two polite, well-intentioned, well-meaning, liberal, progressive scholars, Binding and Hoca, a legal scholar and a medical professor. Because they did not want people to suffer, they were compassionate. They supported mandatory sterilization for some classes of persons, and even what was in those days called mercy killing, euthanasia, for those whose lives they considered so burdensome as to be not worth living. Now, we ourselves, as the return of euthanasia makes clear, live at a time of great moral confusion. If anything, our situation is worse today. You face greater challenges today. The culture sends you worse messages today than it did at the time that Solzhenitsyn spoke at Harvard in 1978. There has been, to borrow a phrase from the philosopher Nietzsche, I'm sure many of you have read in your philosophy courses, there's been what Nietzsche called a transvaluation of values in many spheres. What is bad has been redefined as good. What is good has been redefined as bad. To defend the historic conception of marriage as the conjugal union of husband and wife is to be accused of hatred by woke progressives. To stand up for the sanctity of human life in all stages and conditions, beginning with the defense of the precious and vulnerable child in the womb, is to be risk-labeled a misogynist. To speak out for religious freedom and the rights of conscience is to invite being smeared as a bigot. Many people, many young people, hold their tongues, keep silent, regardless of what's in their hearts, for fear of being tarred and labeled and smeared on social media or elsewhere, at receiving a bad grade from a professor, a prejudiced professor, who won't tolerate dissent from woke progressive orthodoxy. You know what I'm talking about? I'll bet you do. Of course, it's not pleasant. No one's saying it's pleasant to be subjected to abuse and defamation, to be accused of being a hater or a misogynist or a bigot for standing up for what's right, decent, just. And these days, it goes well beyond unpleasantness. To speak moral truth to cultural power, and as David Brooks points out, progressives have a monopoly on cultural power, whether it's the news media, the entertainment media, the intellectual high culture, the universities, the big corporations, the big philanthropies. The left has a monopoly. But to speak moral truth to that cultural power is to put at risk one's standing in polite society, one's educational and employment opportunities, perhaps. Perhaps one's professional advancement. It could be to place in jeopardy treasured friendships and sometimes even family relationships. It is to subject, in some cases, one's business to punishment, perhaps by the misbegotten application of anti-discrimination ordinances, as we've seen in places like Colorado and Washington State, or to boycotts organized by powerful advocacy groups bankrolled by the plutocracy that is increasingly dominant in 21st century corporate America. Josh Hawley was right to point out that what we need are truly free markets, not crony capitalism that invites plutocratic rule. And the more people, in reaction to these threats, acquiesce or go silent, the more dangerous and therefore more difficult it becomes for anyone to speak out loud, even if they know in their hearts what's right and what should be said and what should be confronted and what should be called out and what should be defended and what should be critiqued. Anyone who succumbs to the intimidation and bullying, anyone who acquiesces or goes silent out of fear, not only harms his or her own character and fails in his or her own duty to bear faithful witness to truth, he or she also makes things harder for others. We owe it not only to ourselves to be courageous, but to our brothers and sisters, too. And because we owe it to others, we owe it to God. Our own worst selves are our unvirtuous selves. Our own worst selves are ourselves when we lack the self-mastery that possession of the virtues, including the virtue of courage, centrally including the virtue of courage, makes possible. Our worst selves are slaves, not to alien masters, but to our own weaknesses and wayward desires. Our worst selves are what we are encouraged to be by so much of our culture today. When we are our worst selves, what we seek are ephemeral and ultimately meaningless things. Pleasure, status, social acceptability, wealth, power, celebrity. It's not that these things are bad in themselves. They're not. Good things can be done with them. Power can be used for good ends. Wealth can be used for good ends. Even celebrity can be used for good ends. They're not bad in themselves. But things, the important thing to recognize is that also they are not good just in themselves either. They're only good when we use them for good things. And they can lure us when we focus on them as if they were ends rather than means. They can lure us into supposing that they are what ultimately matters in life. Your lives are ahead of you. You're looking at great opportunities for yourselves personally, for yourselves professionally, for the role that you can play and you want to play. You wouldn't be here if you didn't want to play a role in cultural and political transformation and renewal. But that means it's just so critically important for you to get it right, to understand what's important and what's not, and to understand what is a mere means and what truly need to be our ends. Don't confuse the means with the end. Don't look for power or wealth or celebrity or status for its own sake. And recognize that you may be called on to sacrifice those things for the greater ends to which they are mere means. When we are our worst selves, the desire for ephemeral things and the fear of losing those things if we have them can paralyze us. I've seen it happen to so many people. I've seen it happen in academic life to so many people. When we are our worst selves, we lead lives that are marked by those vices against which Solzhenitsyn railed 41 years ago: materialism, consumerism, self-indulgence, narcissism. We place the focus on doing as we please, no matter what we please, getting what we want, no matter what we want, doing what we happen to want to do, just because we happen to want to do it, instead of seeking what's true because it's true, what's good because it's good, what's right because it's right. Instead, we seek what we desire for no better reason than happening to desire it. Indeed, we fall into the profound moral and philosophical error of imagining that the human good consists merely in the satisfaction of desires. What's wrong at the end of the day with the kind of liberalism that's wrong? Not the liberalism of the American founders or Lincoln or de Tocqueville, but the kind of liberalism that has produced contemporary progressivism. What's behind it at a very deep level is the identification of the good, not with objective reality, but with feeling, desire, getting what you want, emotion, satisfaction. Thus it is that we rationalize our failing to behave like rational creatures, creatures blessed with the godlike powers of freedom and reason, and are behaving instead like brute animals, slaves of our passions. By definition, slaves to passion can never be masters of themselves, and no one who lacks self-mastery can practice and exemplify the virtue of courage. Courage always, always presupposes a willingness to sacrifice oneself for others or for something higher. Someone who is not master of himself or master of herself cannot rise above his or her own wants, desires, passions, can never give himself to others or live for others or give himself or herself to or live for something higher, something he or she regards as greater than just getting one's desires satisfied. Self-mastery is the very precondition of the willingness and ability to live self-sacrificially. One cannot give oneself to others if one is not first master to oneself, because lacking self-mastery, one simply has nothing to give. Now, I've suggested that Solzhenitsyn saw a connection between the decline of courage and a loss of faith. 5 years after his Harvard commencement address, so this would be 1983, in a speech accepting the Templeton Prize in Religion, Solzhenitsyn stated this in the most explicit terms. The title of his speech could not have made the point more clearly. That title was, "Men Have Forgotten God." And here is its opening paragraph. I quote, "As a survivor of the communist Holocaust, I am horrified to witness how my beloved America, my adopted country, is gradually being transformed into a secularist and atheistic utopia, where communist ideals are glorified and promoted, while Judeo-Christian values and morality are ridiculed and increasingly eradicated from public and social consciousness in our nation. Under the decades-long assault and militant radicalism of so-called liberal and progressive elites, God has been progressively erased from our public and educational institutions, to be replaced with all manner of delusion, perversion, corruption, violence, decadence, and insanity," unquote. Now, my young friends, 36 years later, here we are. And can anyone deny the truth of Solzhenitsyn's lament? He foresaw 36 years ago, when it was still in something like embryonic form, what is now so dominant in the culture pressing up against you, and in which you have to form your own characters and arrive at your own conclusions and opinions and convictions. Today, the cultured despisers of religion and Judeo-Christian values do not speak of communism and its ideals, communism having been discredited by Soviet gangsterism. They speak instead of liberation, or equality, or socialism, or social justice. But they seek the same goals, to marginalize and stigmatize the principles of Judeo-Christian morality and justify acts and practices that contravene those principles. And they are certainly aggressive, moving to cite just one of many examples, from the legalization of abortion to the demand for its approval and even public funding, to the insistence that people or institutions, including religious institutions such as Catholic hospitals who refuse to perform or refer for abortions, be made to suffer professional or civic penalties and disabilities. It wasn't that many years ago when the mainstream liberal movement and mainstream Democratic politicians, people like Bill and Hillary Clinton, would say that abortion is a tragic necessity, something that should be safe, legal, and rare. You would be expelled from the Democratic Party and progressive movement today for conceding even that much to the pro-life cause. Today, it's abortion up to, and who knows, perhaps after birth, for any reason, elevating the practice to something like sacramental stature in what is increasingly like a neo-pagan religion. Now, what's behind all of this? According to Solzhenitsyn, the moral decline of the West has behind it the same factor that produced the horrors of communism, namely this: men have forgotten God. People worship themselves, deify their own desires and feelings, fall into an idolatry of the self, because they have forgotten there is something, indeed someone, higher. They have forgotten God. And absent faith in God, absent faith in a higher power, in something higher than ourselves, how can they or we muster the courage to bear bold and faithful witness, as Solzhenitsyn himself did, to essential moral values in an increasingly hostile culture and world? How can there be courage in the absence of faith? Fear is a powerful emotion. We've all felt it. It's powerful. It can hold you in its grip. It can paralyze you. It's a very powerful emotion indeed. Faith alone can overcome it. When people forget God, when they come to suppose that they don't need Him or His grace and guidance. When they fall into the hubristic error of imagining that they are too smart or sophisticated to believe in God, a catastrophe always ensues. This was no novel insight of Alexander Solzhenitsyn's. It's the central teaching and theme of the prophets, all prophets, not just the biblical ones. In March of 1863, another man with a craggy face and a beard spoke to the American people words of critique and prophetic warning of precisely the sort spoken by Solzhenitsyn at Harvard and in his Templeton address. Abraham Lincoln, reflecting on the catastrophe of the Civil War and on its causes, issued a proclamation of a day of prayer and fasting. We don't hear much about this these days. People aren't taught about Lincoln's proclamation of a day of fasting and prayer. But he did issue the proclamation. What he said in the proclamation was, in a sense, echoed by Solzhenitsyn, and we would do well to heed it today. Indeed, we fail to heed it at our moral peril. Here are Lincoln's words. Whereas it is the duty of nations, as well as men, to own their dependence upon the overruling power of God, to confess their sins and transgressions in humble sorrow, yet with assured hope that genuine repentance will lead to mercy and pardon, and to recognize the sublime truth announced in the Holy Scriptures and proven by all history, that those nations alone are blessed whose God is the Lord. And insomuch as we know that by his divine law, nations like individuals are subjected to punishments and chastisements in this world, may we not justly fear that the awful calamity of civil war, which now desolates the land, may be but a punishment inflicted upon us for our presumptuous sins to the needful end of our national reformation as a whole people. We have been the recipients, Lincoln goes on, of the choicest bounties of heaven. We have been preserved these many years in peace and prosperity. We have grown in numbers, wealth, and power as no nation has ever grown. But we have forgotten God. We have forgotten the gracious hand which preserved us in peace and multiplied and enriched and strengthened us. And we have vainly imagined in the deceitfulness of our hearts that all these blessings were produced by some superior wisdom and virtue of our own. Intoxicated with unbroken success, we have become too self-sufficient to feel the necessity of redeeming and preserving grace, too proud to pray to the God that made us." Unquote. That was Abraham Lincoln. Abraham Lincoln, revered by progressives as much as by conservatives. But do they listen to his words? Do they heed his warning? Do they even recognize the Lincoln of that proclamation? It's been more than a century and a half since Abraham Lincoln wrote those words. And yet, to me at least, it is as if he wrote them yesterday and directed them to us today. Yes, as a culture, as a people, we have forgotten God. That is reflected in some of our laws, in some of the edicts of our courts, in our public policies, in our news and entertainment media, to be sure, in our schools and certainly in our universities, in our economic and cultural institutions, on the streets of our cities, and even, alas, in many homes. We have indeed vainly imagined in the deceitfulness of our hearts that our blessings were produced by some superior wisdom and virtue of our own. And as a result, we find ourselves in the condition so accurately and brutally diagnosed by Solzhenitsyn. And the economic prosperity that we should be very grateful to be enjoying now is ultimately no salve against our problem. But my friends, what has been forgotten can be remembered. What has fallen into decay can be renewed. What has been lost can be rediscovered. But for these things to happen, those who have not forgotten God and sincerely seek to do His will must look to Him for the grace necessary to be His courageous and faithful witnesses. To be, in the words of another modern prophet, Pope John Paul II, signs of contradiction to a culture and a world that has forgotten God. This is not easy. It's not easy in your colleges and universities. It's not easy in the culture you inhabit. It's certainly not easy in the elite sector of the culture. But it is our mission. It is particularly our mission as conservatives and above all as patriots. We must remember God to a world that has indeed, as Lincoln said, as Solzhenitsyn said, forgotten Him. By the example of our own lives, as well as by the words of our mouths, responding to the promptings of both faith and reason, never imagining that the two can be separated in our moral witness, we must be the salt and light that repairs what is broken and points the way to true freedom, the freedom that is ultimately worth having for those who've fallen into forms of slavery that are all the more abject for masquerading as liberation. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. I think we have time for some, I mean, at least a few questions, I think. Do we? Can I recognize you over there, ma'am?
Sorry. Yeah. Hi. I'm Kitty Fields. I go to George Mason University. So my question is kind of, like, it's twofold, and it's kind of a practical question. So it seems to me that, like, if we look at our ancestors and all of the things they did, it seems like suffering is kind of the soil from which virtues can grow. So my question is, in such a prosperous country where our lives are so comfortable and we aren't in the midst of any war or strife, how do we practice the virtue of courage? And then also in an age where secularism is like the cultural default and all things kind of stand to the scrutiny of material sciences, how do we regain our faith and restore our spiritual fervor?
Wonderful question. The first point I would make, yes, thank you. The first point I would make is to remind ourselves that we are not lacking in opportunities for exemplifying the virtue of courage. The fact that we are economically prosperous, that most of us don't have to suffer materially, we don't have to worry about where our next meal is coming from, doesn't mean that we are never going to be afraid. Now, we have the option of living the kinds of comfortable lives that are comfortable because we simply avoid fulfilling our responsibilities to speak truth to power, to bear bold witness. But that comfort is not worth the price. That comfort is not worth the price of failing in our mission, failing to be persons of integrity, failing to be the kinds of people that we can be and that we're called to be by both faith and reason, which means we have to discipline ourselves to take on the challenges that it is our lot to face. Those challenges today, for most of us, most of the time, again, are not material. They are moral and spiritual. But I would submit to you that in some respects, that means they're even tougher challenges. You know, I'd rather, in the absence of any kind of moral conviction, unless I'm morally motivated, I would rather skip a meal than be called a bad name, be called a racist, be called a bigot, be called a hater, be ostracized be marginalized. And yet, all of us are called to bear the risk of being called those names, of being ostracized, of being marginalized for the sake of what is true. I think what we need to do is to keep the truth firmly before our eyes, as best we can understand the truth. Now, we recognize that we don't have a monopoly on truth. We don't know the whole truth. We will never in this veil of tears know the whole truth. But as best we understand the truth, to put it in Lincoln's terms, we should pursue the right with firmness in the right as God gives us to see the right. The best we can, we need to remain focused on the truth and willing to speak truth to power. And boy, that's tough. I'm not going to pretend it's not tough. Gosh, I come from a university. I come from that sector of the culture. I know how tough it is. But you can do it. You can do it. Now, having said that, let me be honest with you. There will be victims. People will be marginalized. People will lose jobs. People will lose professional opportunities. People will lose businesses. That will happen. Just as when our soldiers stormed the beaches of Normandy, they knew there would be men who would remain in cemeteries under white crosses and stars of David in Normandy. Yeah, but we can win the victory. Understanding that there's something greater than ourselves that's worth fighting for, worth mustering the courage to fight for, we can win the victory. And then one final thing. It will be easier for all of us, the more of us stand and speak and bear faithful witness. The fewer of us who do that, the rougher the consequences for the few who do. So we owe it to each other to stand firm, arm in arm, bearing faithful witness, keeping in the forefront of our minds love of truth. Thank you. You, sir.
I'm Patrick Warren. I'm from Utah. And I was wondering if you could give any advice on how we can combat the growing sentiment of nihilism and hedonism, and like you mentioned, consumerism.
Yeah. By example, as well as by pronouncement. It's been attributed to various people. I know Francis of Assisi sometimes is said to be the author of this line, but there's a line that says, and this is just to put it in Christian terms, you don't have to put it in Christian terms, but in Christian terms, always preach the gospel, use words if necessary. And what he's pointing to, whoever said that, what he's pointing to is the way in which the example of our lives teaches even more than the pronouncements of our mouths. Now, that is by no means to excuse anybody. You are not excused, at least as far as I'm concerned, from speaking. It's not enough to set a good example, but it is a requirement to set a good example. We ourselves have to show the superior way. Narcissism, self-indulgence, selfishness, these are dead ends. These are destructive of human happiness, of human flourishing. Because we care about people, rich and poor, black and white, both sexes, because we care about people, we want to save people from those dead end lives. They may be rich, they may be powerful, they may be celebrities, they may have high social standing, but if you're a narcissist, if you're self-indulgent, you're headed for a dead end. That's no way to live. And so, we have to bear witness with our mouths, and even more fundamentally, show by example what a worthwhile life is. Lead by example. That's absolutely true. That's how
Thank you
do
you.
It.
Yep.
Liam
Over
Cooney,
here, sir.
College of Lake County. I'd like to ask, I'm sorry. As you speak the truth and review your speech of these morals and virtues, you speak about pretty much how do you pretty much comprehend with these people realizing that, hey, militant secularism is an oppressive form of theocracy, just in a different sense, just because it's not religious, and then pretty much everything just breaks down. You're like, there better be a rapture.
It better be a
rapture. Now, I'm not saying that there isn't one or you don't believe in one, but more like, you're just saying, one day, we will prove to you You will suffer. You will laugh now. You will stand high and tall. But hell, you will fall. And it is permanent. Yeah. It is permanent.
Well,
at what point has that affected your career multiple times as you deal with people who threaten you along with your colleagues and people like us? Many times.
Well, first of all, I think your point about ideology and dominant modern ideologies like communism or the sort of extreme forms of progressivism that we're now seeing mainstreamed in our country, these are alternative religions. You're absolutely right. It's a mistake to think of those as this other category of thing. They're not. They're religions that compete with the historic traditional religions, with Christianity and Judaism and Islam and Buddhism and Hinduism. They're just an alternative. They propose an account of the human good, of human dignity, of human decency, of human destiny. It's just a very different, radically different account, an emotivist account of those things. So we have to be prepared to defend the traditional account with reason, not just on the basis of quoting the Bible or the scripture. We have to be able to defend with reason against these alternative neo-pagan religions, traditional moral views. And we defend them by showing that in them we do find human flourishing. We cannot flourish if we live simply for feeling, live simply for satisfaction. If we suppose that there are no objective goods, no objective right and wrong, that everything just depends on how one feels. One can even manufacture oneself on the basis of whether one feels this way or that way today, or feels like a man or a woman, or feels like I would be better off living in some way that those of the traditional faiths know is the way to disaster. So we have to be prepared. Now, how can we be prepared? There are great resources, great philosophical resources. Not everybody has to become a philosopher, but I think everybody who wants to bear faithful witness in this culture with the hostile forces that we're up against, and you're right, I mean, in my career, I've faced them. You guys will face them. Many of you are facing them already. We need to be prepared to equip ourselves with some fundamental reading to do battle in the realm of ideas. You can begin rather simply. A classic work is C.S. Lewis's The Abolition of Man. Lewis was doing the very battle that we're engaged in all the way back in the pre-World War II period. Read The Abolition of Man. It's a great book. It's an easy read, but it equips you to do intellectual battle at a very high level. Also, I'd commend to you a new book as a description of our situation by Stephen Smith of the University of San Diego Law School, a great book called Pagans and Christians in the City. Smith, more forcefully and I think more effectively than anyone else, rigorously shows the way the new progressive ideologies have become an alternative pagan religion, reviving some of the principles of the paganism that Judaism and Christianity defeated in the immediate pre-Christian period. Over here. Jackson.
Dr. George, my name is Jackson. I go to Mississippi State University. And you almost answered my question a little bit right there, but what extra biblical written works have most influenced your worldview?
Well, it's kind of you to ask that, Jackson. The most transformative, the central intellectual experience in my life came when I was, I believe, a sophomore. Might have been second semester freshman, but I believe it was first semester sophomore year when I was in college. When I was taking an ordinary survey course, an introduction to political theory, Plato to NATO. And my professor, who was a perfectly fine professor, not anything special, but perfectly good professor, competent professor, had us read Plato's dialogue, Gorgias.
Which one was that?
Gorgias. Gorgias is a sophist. You know, the sophists are the guys that Socrates is always arguing with in the dialogues. And Gorgias is the sort of least unpleasant, the least nasty, the nicest sophist. He's just basically a law professor. He teaches kids to make arguments, young men, so that they can rise and be people of stature and celebrity in the Athenian public sphere. He teaches them how to make arguments. He doesn't care which side they're on. He teaches them to make good arguments for whatever side they're on and to win debates. He's interested in teaching students for the sake of victory. And of course, what Socrates comes along and contends with him about is whether that's what really matters. Should we teach students to argue for victory, or shouldn't we be teaching them to argue for truth? Isn't it truth that matters ultimately, not victory? Well, the light bulb went off over my head. As someone who had done debate in high school and who loved debate and who loved winning arguments, was pretty good at it, I had just fallen into the trap of thinking that the use of the mind is really all about winning, not just in formal, stylized, competitive debates, but in life more generally. And the lesson I drew from the dialogue, the lesson that old Greek taught me was, no, that's secondary, that's ephemeral, that's not really what matters. What really matters is truth, getting at the truth. And that put me on an entirely different trajectory than I ever imagined I would go on, and led me to the vocation that that I have pursued, lo these many years. So there's nothing that I can recommend to you more highly than to begin by reading Plato's dialogues. If you haven't had a chance to do that in your philosophy courses or political theory courses in college, just do it on your own. Make it summer reading. Read the Apology, read the Credo, read the Euthyphro, read Gorgias. Acquaint yourself with, in fact, make it a mission, make it part of your job to acquaint yourself with the greatest works of the Western tradition. They're magnificent, and they're so badly neglected today when we really need them most. In fact, it's probably no accident that the neglect of those works corresponds to some of the ethical and moral collapses that we see today. We've kind of lost the wisdom of our fathers, not just our religious teachers, not just our great religious figures like St. Augustine or St. Thomas Aquinas or Maimonides, but even the great virtuous pagan Greek and Roman thinkers, Plato, Aristotle, Cicero. It's a great place to begin. Over here.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. George. I just wanted to ask, listening to your speech, one of the ideologies that has creeped up over the past 10, 15 years that bothers me the most is the ideology of transgenderism, especially in very liberal areas, and it bothers me that I see it a lot defended even sometimes by very liberal Christian churches. And I was wondering what we can do to combat it as an ideology, and it also plays into what you were talking about satisfaction becoming the human moral good. And I was wondering your ideas.
I think you've put the focus in talking about this issue where it belongs, on the critique of it, of gender theory or gender ideology or transgender ideology, precisely as an ideology.
Yes.
That's where we need the critique. That is to be distinguished from the actual flesh and blood human beings, our brothers and sisters, who suffer, who experience gender dysphoria, who experience a mismatch between their physical bodies and their sense, their intellectual or spiritual sense of who they are. By all accounts, and I've read a great deal on the subject, and many, many personal accounts with people from different perspectives, but by all accounts, it can be torture to experience that. We should have nothing but the deepest compassion and concern for people who experience gender dysphorias, as we should for people who experience other sorts of dysphorias. And there are many different sorts and forms of dysphoria.
Thank you so much for your time.
But the ideology reflects something deeper. It's not something new here or something unique. It's the deeper ideology that what I am, what the person is the feelings that the person has. What I am is a center of consciousness, desire, emotion, feeling that merely inhabits and uses a body as if it were an extrinsic instrument. An old heresy going all the way back to the early centuries of the Christian era called Gnosticism has returned in a virulent form. Central to Gnosticism, which had many different variants, and some were highly aesthetic, some were the opposite of aesthetic, others the opposite of aesthetic. One thing they all had in common was the separation of self or mind or soul or spirit and body. So the Gnostic picture of the human being is as a non-bodily person, a center of consciousness, feeling, emotion, who inhabits and uses a non-personal body. And this was the view that Judaism and Christianity pushed over against, defending the idea that the body is not something sub-personal, but rather is part of the personal reality of the human being. That view, which has its roots actually in Greek philosophy, pre-Christian Greek philosophy, and Aristotle, who called the view hylomorphism, that view is that the human person is not a non-bodily person inhabiting a non-personal body, but the person rather is a dynamic unity of body and mind, or body and spirit, the body being part of the personal reality of the human being. So we don't merely inhabit our bodies the way a driver sits in a car and steers it one direction or another as an extrinsic instrument. We are our bodies, whatever else we are. This doesn't mean that we're simply material. It's not to embrace materialism, but it's to recognize the unity, the inseparable unity of body and soul. What transgenderism, what the abortion license, what euthanasia, what progressive sexual ethics all presuppose is the Gnostic dualistic picture of the human person as a set of feelings or desires or consciousness that inhabits a non-personal body. That separation of person and body underwrites the progressive social agenda. If that's a little obscure to you, and you can be forgiven if it is on this brief account, could I recommend one of my own writings, which is my paper from the December 16th, you can get it online, December 2016 issue of First Things magazine, called Gnostic Liberalism. In Gnostic Liberalism, I try to show that these various teachings of contemporary woke progressivism reflect this separation of person and body. And so, for example, abortion is justified, even though we know the child developing in the womb is a living member of the species Homo sapiens. From a biological point of view, nobody, except extremely ignorant people, nobody denies that what we have is a human being. But of course, what proponents of abortion do want to claim is we don't yet have a person. What's missing? It's sense of self, self-awareness, emotion, feeling, rationality. So they separate mind and body to say it's all right to kill a human being who's not yet a person because there is this distinction, same at the other end of life. Well, Uncle Henry, yeah, of course he's a demented Uncle Henry suffering from Alzheimer's disease. Of course he's a human being, he's a biological member of the human species, but he's no longer a person. He was a person, but he's no longer a person. Again, this separation of person and body, this Gnostic dualism. So on this neo-Gnostic progressive view, there are pre-personal human beings who aren't yet persons, but if they're allowed to live, will become them, and there are post-personal human beings who once were persons but are no longer persons, and of course, as my colleague Peter Singer argues at Princeton, there are some human beings who, because of congenital severe cognitive disability, were never persons and are not persons now and will never be persons. And therefore, from a moral point of view, there would be nothing wrong with killing them. And we could go through the same arguments with transgenderism, the idea that I might be a biological male, but I'm a psychological female, same separation of person and body, which is in the end, for reasons that I articulate in the article, simply philosophically untenable. Same with liberal, progressive, woke views about sexual morality. Thank you again very much. It's always a great pleasure and honor to be back here with the YAFers. God bless all of you. Bye-bye.